Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents How to Study, the program that has helped millions of students study smarter, not harder, by Ron Fry, read by Patrick Lawlor. Introduction. Study to succeed. Learning is its own exceeding great reward. William Hazlitt. As I began preparing this new edition, I wasn't sure how drastically I would need to change it. Had technology, from smart boards and smartphones to a million apps and a zillion websites, so altered the educational landscape that many of the study tips and techniques I'd written about were obsolete? Thinking about all of the technological changes that have occurred in the last decade spurred me to rethink every aspect of this book. Were there now easier or more efficient ways to accomplish the same age-old study tasks? Were there new problems that had to be addressed? Were there suggestions or tools that were now hopelessly out of date? Since, as Montaigne declared, a man must always study, I am happy to report that today's successful student needs to master the same basic set of study skills. However, the most efficient way to master them, and especially the variety of tools available to do so, clearly have grown and evolved. So this edition of How to Study still includes hints, advice, and techniques for reading, understanding, and remembering what you read, taking notes in class, from your textbooks, in the library, and online, how to prepare for and do better on all kinds of tests, how to research and prepare great papers and oral reports, and how to organize your study schedule to get the best results in the shortest amount of time. But there are essential skills you may think have nothing to do with studying, and important steps you need to take right from the start that we will cover first. Here's where to start. Learning without thought is labor lost. Thought without learning is perilous. Confucius. Developing great study habits is like a foot race between you and your friends. Before you can declare a winner, you have to agree on where the finish line is. In other words, how do you measure your ability to use these skills? What's a good result? What's a poor one? But you can't even start the race until you know where the starting line is, especially if it's drawn at a different spot for each of you. Chapter 1 starts by explaining each study skill and clarifying how each can and should function in your life. Then you'll be given the chance to identify your own starting line. In Chapter 2, you'll learn the importance of where, how, and when you study, and you will start building the study environment that's perfect for you. There is no magic elixir in the study habit regimen. If math and science are not your strong suits, memorizing how to study will not transform you into a Nobel Prize-winning physicist. Nobody is great at everything, but everybody is great at something. So you'll also get a chance to rate the subjects you like and dislike, and those that are your best and worst. Chapter 2 also introduces some of the intangibles in the study equation: your home environment, attitude, motivation, and so forth. If you are dedicated to studying and motivated to achieve certain goals, all the other factors that affect your study habits will fall more naturally into place. A belief in the study ethic is one of the keys to success. Finally, mastering some other key components of the study process, learning to read teachers, developing mentors, dealing with perfectionism, the importance of flexibility, will help you get off to the right start. Reading and comprehension. Chapter 3 introduces the skills basic to any study process: reading and comprehension. No matter how well you learn to take notes, how familiar you become with your library, how deftly you operate online, and how doggedly you study for tests, if you are reading poorly, or not enough, and not understanding or remembering what you read, life will be difficult. Becoming a good reader is a skill, one usually acquired early in life. If it's a skill you haven't acquired yet, now is the time. Maximize your memory. In Chapter 4, I have reintroduced memory tips, tricks, and techniques that were eliminated in earlier editions to keep this book at a manageable length. But I think learning how to remember numbers, memorize long lists, create chain-link stories, and other essential memory techniques are too important to leave out. I have also moved some of the material previously included in Chapter 3, How to Remember More of What You Read, into this new chapter. Making up for lost time. To see a significant change in your life, many of you will not need to study harder, just smarter. This means making better use of your study time, spending the same 2, 3, or 4 hours, but accomplishing twice, thrice, or 4 times as much. Chapter 5 introduces a number of simple and easy-to-use organizational and time management tools, powerful ways to make sure you are always on track and on time. Go to the head of the class. In Chapter 6, I talk about the one experience we all have in common, no matter how old we are: the classroom. I'll help you take better notes in every kind of classroom, encourage your active participation in class discussions, and help you get a lot more out of lectures. Create a great term paper. In early editions of this book, I included a chapter on using your library, later changed to How to Conduct Your Research, so as to incorporate the now far more prevalent use of online resources. It was a relatively short chapter, followed by a far longer one detailing all the other steps necessary to produce a terrific essay, term paper, or oral report. In this edition, I have rearranged these two chapters so they are more equal in length. So, Chapter 7 now covers all the preparatory steps to complete any writing assignment, from choosing a topic and establishing a long-term schedule to establishing an initial thesis, creating a rough outline, and conducting research in the library and/or online. I still briefly review the two major library classification systems, Dewey Decimal and Library of Congress, and show you how to conduct efficient online research without falling prey, for hours, to the "let's just follow that interesting link" syndrome. Chapter 8 now assumes most, if not all, of your research has been completed and takes you through the actual organizational and writing processes, from creating your first draft through rewriting, proofreading, and finalizing footnotes to the appendices and the bibliography. It also includes a brief section on the key differences between producing a written report and presenting the same information orally. How to ace any test. Chapter 9 covers the do's and don'ts of test preparation, including the differences between studying for weekly quizzes, midterms, and final examinations, why last-minute cramming doesn't work, but how to do it if you have no choice. Shame. Studying for and taking different types of tests, multiple choice, true-false, essay, open book, and so on. How to increase your guessing scores, even which questions to answer first and which to leave for last. How smart do you study? How to Study is the most comprehensive study guide ever written, a fundamental step-by-step approach that anyone can follow to develop and sharpen his or her study skills. If you're struggling through college or graduate school, here's your life preserver. If you're a high school student planning to attend college, now's your chance to hone your study skills. If you're not considering college, even if you're ready to drop out of high school at the earliest possible opportunity, you still need How to Study. If you're an adult returning to the classroom after a lengthy absence, there's no substitute for the tips and techniques you will learn in this book. What if you're a really poor student? How smart you are is not the point. What counts is how smart you study. With the possible exception of the 2% of you who qualify as gifted, how to study will help students of any age and ability level. If your grades are average to good, you will see a definite improvement. If you are barely passing, you will benefit considerably. If good study habits are in place but rusty as a result of years away from the classroom, how to study will be the perfect refresher for you. And if you are one of those gifted 2%, I still think you'll find many helpful techniques in these chapters. Who is this book really for? Although I originally wrote How to Study for high school students, I've discovered over the years that many more audiences have benefited from it. The surprise was that so many of the people buying How to Study were adults. Yes, a number of them were returning to school and saw How to Study as a great refresher. And some were long out of school, but had figured out that if they could learn now the study skills their teachers never taught them, or they never took the time to learn, they would do better in their careers. All too many were parents who had the same lament. How do I get Johnny to read, show up on time, remember more, get better grades? So I want to briefly take the time to address every one of the audiences for this book and discuss some of the factors particular to each of you. If you're a high school student, you should be particularly comfortable with the format of the book. It's relatively short sentences and paragraphs, occasionally humorous, hopefully, headings and subheadings, and the language used. I did originally write it with you in mind. But you should also be uncomfortable with the fact that you're already in the middle of your school years, the period that will drastically affect one way or the other all the rest of your school years, and you still don't know how to study. Don't lose another minute. Make learning how to study and mastering all of the study skills in this book your absolute priority. If you're a middle school student, congratulations! You're learning how to study at precisely the right time. 6th, 7th, and 8th grades, before that sometimes cosmic leap to high school, is without a doubt the period in which all these study skills should be mastered. Doing so will make high school not just easier, but a far more positive and successful experience. If you're a traditional college student, if you are somewhere in the 18 to 25 age range, I hope you are tackling one or two of the study skills you failed to master in high school. If you are deficient in more areas than that and failed to address all of them, I can't see how you're ever going to succeed in college. Then again, I can't figure out how you managed to get into college. If you are starting from scratch, my advice is the same as to the high school students listening to this book. Make learning how to study your top priority. If you're a non-traditional student, if you're going back to high school, college, or graduate school at age 25, 45, 65, or 85, you probably need the help in how to study more than anyone. The longer you've been out of school, the more likely you don't remember what you've forgotten. And you've forgotten what you're supposed to remember. As much as I emphasize that it's rarely too early to learn good study habits, I must also emphasize that it's never too late. What can parents do? Education, like neurosis, begins at home. Milton Saperstein. There are probably even more dedicated parents out there than dedicated students, since the first phone call at any of my radio or TV appearances inevitably comes from a sincere and worried parent asking, "What can I do to help my kid do better in school?" Here are the rules for parents of students of any age. Set up a homework area, free of distraction, well lit, with all necessary supplies handy. Set up a homework routine. Studies have clearly shown that students who establish a regular routine are better organized and, as a result, more successful. Set homework priorities. Actually, just make the point that homework is the priority. Before a date, before TV, before going out to play, whatever. Make reading a habit. For them, certainly, but also for yourselves. Kids will inevitably do what you do, not what you say, even if you say not to do what you do. So if you keep nagging them to read while you settle in for a 24-hour Breaking Bad marathon, please consider the mixed message you are sending. Turn off the TV, or at the very least, severely limit when and how much TV watching is appropriate. This may be the toughest suggestion to implement. I know. I weathered the Sturm und Drang of my daughter's teenaged years. Talk to the teachers. Find out what your kids are supposed to be learning. How else will you know what help they need? You may even be helping them in ways that are at odds with what the teacher is trying to accomplish. Encourage and motivate, but don't nag them to do their homework. It doesn't work. The more you insist, the quicker they will tune you out. Supervise their work, but don't fall into the trap of doing their homework for them. Proofreading a paper, for example, is a positive way to help your child in school. But if you then enter all the corrections yourself, your child has learned nothing, except that she is not responsible for her own homework. Praise them when they succeed, but don't overpraise them for mediocre work. Kids have well-attuned antennae for insincerity. Convince older students of reality. Learning and believing that the real world won't care about their grades, but will measure them by what they know and what they can do, is a lesson that will save many tears, probably yours. It's probably never too early to carefully and tenderly inform your little genius that life really isn't fair, and give him or her the resources to help deal with that fact. Make sure your kids have the technology they need to succeed. Whatever their age, your kids really must be computer savvy and have internet access in order to survive in and after school. Turn off the TV already! Hide their cell phone and turn off IM, instant messaging, and text alerts while they are doing homework. They will inevitably try to convince you that texts, chats, alerts, and messages will in no way interfere with their algebra homework. Parents who buy this argument have also been persuaded that sitting in front of the TV is the best place to study. Are you ready to learn something? The book you are listening to is now in its 8th edition and has been helping students and parents, and even teachers, for more than 25 years. If you need even more help in a particular area, there are 5 other specific titles in Ron Fry's How to Study program: Ace Any Test, Get Organized, Improve Your Memory, Improve Your Reading, and Improve Your Writing. Thank you for making all of these books successful. Learning shouldn't be painful or boring, though it is occasionally both. I don't promise that How to Study will make everything easier. It won't. It can't. And it may actually require some work to achieve what you want. But How to Study will illuminate the path, give you directions, and make sure you're properly provisioned for your journey. In some classes, you will not understand everything the first time you read it or hear it, or perhaps even the second or third time. You may have to learn it slowly, very slowly. But that doesn't mean there's something wrong with you. It may be a subject that everyone learns slowly. My particular nemesis was physical chemistry. A poorly written textbook or unmotivated teacher can make any subject difficult. You will also inevitably decide that one or more courses couldn't possibly be of any use later in life. I don't have a clue why I need to learn trigonometry, physics, French literature, European history, fill in the blank, you wail. I will never use it. Believe me, You have no idea what you may or may not need, use, or remember next week, let alone in a decade. In my experience, a surprising amount of useless information and learning wound up being vitally important to my professional career. So learn it all. Get excited about the process of learning, and I guarantee you will not ever worry about what you will need to know in the future. I immodestly maintain that How to Study is the best book on the market. There are certainly lots of other study books out there. Unfortunately, I don't think many of them deliver what they promise. The author of one such title spent barely half a dozen pages on time management and 26 pages discussing the importance of sleep, exercise, and nutrition, including sample menus. I see little reason to waste your time detailing what should be obvious. Anything, including studying, is more difficult if you're tired, hungry, unhealthy, drunk, stoned, and so on. So please, use common sense. Eat as healthily as you can, get whatever sleep your body requires, stay reasonably fit, and avoid alcohol and drugs. If your lack of success is in any way due to one of these other factors and you're unable to deal with it alone, find a good book or a professional to help you. Another author posed some basic questions. When should I study? Where should I study? How long should I study? He then provided his absolute answers. Early, in isolation, and no more than an hour at a time. As far as I'm concerned, there are few rights and wrongs out there in the study world. There's certainly no single right way to attack a multiple choice test or absolute right way to take notes. So don't get fooled into thinking there is, especially if what you're doing seems to be working for you. Don't change what ain't broke just because some self-proclaimed study guru claims what you're doing is all wet. Maybe she's all wet. Needless to say, don't listen to my books looking for some single, inestimable system of rules that works for everyone. You won't find it, 'cause there's no such bird. You will find a plethora of techniques, tips, tricks, gimmicks, and what have yous, some or all of which will work for you, some of which won't. Pick and choose, change and adapt. Figure out what works for you, because you are responsible for creating your study system, not me. I think we've spent enough time talking about what you're going to learn. Let's get on with the learning. Ron Fry. Chapter 1. Start off right. Learn what you are and be such. Pindar. In the next two chapters, I'm going to help you evaluate the current level of all your study skills so you can identify those areas in which you need to concentrate your efforts, identify the study environment and learning style that suit you, and categorize all of your school subjects according to how well you like them and how well you do in them. How to keep score. I'll explain the primary study skills covered in this book. Reading and comprehension, memory development, time management, note-taking in your textbooks, in class, in the library, while online, classroom participation, researching and writing papers, and test preparation. Then I'll ask you to rate yourself on your current level of achievement and understanding of each. A, excellent for mastery or near mastery of a particular skill. B, good for some mastery. C, fair to poor for little or no mastery. But let's do a general test first, just to give you a taste of what's to come. Number a piece of paper 1 through 28. Listen to the following 28 statements and consider which apply to you. If a statement does apply, answer yes. If not, answer no. 1. I wish I could read faster. 2. I go to class, but I don't pay a lot of attention. 3. I rarely review for tests, but I do spend hours cramming the night before. 4. I think I spend more time studying than I need to. 5. I usually study with the TV on and constantly check my cell phone. 6. I rarely finish all my homework on time. 7. I usually write assigned papers the week or the night before they're due. 8. I read every book at the same speed and in the same way. 9. I can never seem to find the information I need on the internet. 10. I'm overwhelmed with too much homework. 11. I can never complete my reading assignments on time. 12. I always seem to write down the wrong stuff in class. 13. I frequently forget important assignments and test dates. 14. I get nervous before exams and do worse than I think I should. 15. I frequently must reread whole passages 2 or 3 times before I understand them. 16. When I finish reading a chapter, I usually don't remember much of it. 17. I try to take down everything the teacher says, but usually can't understand any of my notes. 18. I can only study for about 15 minutes before I get bored or distracted. 19. When I'm working on a paper or report, I spend most of the time with a thesaurus in my lap. 20. I always seem to study the wrong stuff. 21. I don't use any kind of calendar. 22. I study for some tests, but I always forget what I studied when I get there. 23. I don't have enough time to do well in school and still have a social life. 24. I can't figure out the important points in my textbooks. 25. When I look at my class notes right before a test, I can't understand them. 26. I hate to read. 27. I get marked down on essay tests because I don't organize them well. 28. I spend a lot of time on my computer, but it feels like most of it is wasted. What do your answers mean? If you answered yes to questions 2, 5, or 18, you need to work on your concentration. 1, 8, 15, 16, 24, or 26, your reading and comprehension skills are holding you back. 3, 14, or 22, you need to learn the proper way to study for tests and how to reduce test anxiety. 4, 6, 10, 11, 13, 21, or 23, your organizational skills are letting you down. 7, 19, or 27, you're spending a lot of time writing papers but haven't learned how to properly research or organize them. 9 or 28, you need to hone your computer skills and learn how to efficiently identify pertinent information online. 12, 17, 20, or 25, you need a better system for taking notes in class and from your textbooks. It's not as important how many yes answers you had as it is how many were grouped in a specific area, the one in which you obviously need help, though 10 or more yes answers would indicate problems in more than a single area. Let's go into a little more detail and get an even firmer handle on the current state of your study skills. Take a separate piece of paper and rate yourself on each of the study skills, from reading and comprehension through test preparation, before you listen to the rest of this chapter. Then give yourself 2 points for every A, 1 point for every B, and 0 points for every C. If your overall rating is 17 or more, give yourself an A on the initial self-evaluation line. 13 to 16, give yourself a B, and if 12 or less, give yourself a C. This is your assessment of your study habits as they exist right now. Now let's review each of these areas and get a better understanding of what excellent, good, and fair really mean. As you listen to each section, fill in your rating on the Your Starting Point chart and be honest with yourself. This evaluation will give you a benchmark from which to measure your improvement after you've finished how to study. File it away and make the comparison when you've completed the book. Remember, there are no right or wrong answers in either of these assessments. They are jumping-off points from which you can measure your progress and identify those areas in which your skills need improvement. Your starting point. Give yourself an A, B, or C for each. Initial self-evaluation. Reading and comprehension. Memory development. Time management. Textbook note-taking, taking notes in class, library note-taking, taking notes online, classroom participation, writing papers, test preparation, overall study skill level. Reading and comprehension. Speed, comprehension, and recall are the three important components of reading. Comprehension and recall are especially interrelated. Better to sacrifice some speed to increase these two factors. To test your reading and comprehension skills, read a passage from one of your textbooks. Then close the book, jot down the key points made in the selection you read, review the text, and compare your notes with the reading selection. You will get a good idea of how well you understood what you read and just how good your top-of-the-mind recall is. Score. If you can read the material straight through, accurately summarize what you've read, even remember key names and statistics, all in less than 2 minutes, award yourself an A. If you have some problems reading and understanding the text, but are able to complete the assignment in less than 4 minutes, give yourself a B. If you are unable to complete the assignment in that time, remember what you read, or produce accurate notes at all, give yourself a C. Memory development. Test number 1. Look at a line of numbers with several digits, optimally around 15. For 10 seconds, then cover the page and write down as much of it as you can remember. Score. If you remembered 12 or more digits in the correct order, give yourself an A. 8 to 11, a B. 7 or less, a C. Time management. Your effective use of available study time can be measured by 2 yardsticks. 1. Your ability to break down assignments into component parts, for example, reading, note-taking, outlining, writing, and 2. Your ability to complete each task in an efficient manner. Score. If you feel you use your time wisely and efficiently, give yourself an A. If you know there are times you simply run out of time, give yourself a B. If you can't tell time, give yourself a C. Taking clear and effective notes. 4 different arenas, at home with your textbook, in the classroom, at the library, and online, require different methods of note-taking. From your textbooks, working from your book at home, you should identify the main ideas, rephrase information in your own words, and capture unfamiliar details. As you read, take brief, concise notes in a separate notebook or the text's margins, or highlight and/or underline pertinent information in the text. You should write down questions and answers to ensure your mastery of the material, starring those questions for which you don't have answers so you can ask them in class. In class, class preparation is the key to class participation. By reading material to be covered before class, you will be able to concentrate and absorb the teacher's interpretations and points. Using a topical short sentence approach, or your own shorthand or symbols, take notes on those items that will help you remember and recall the subject matter. Your notes should be sequential, following the teacher's lecture pattern. Review your notes at the first opportunity following class. Fill in any blanks and add your own thoughts. In the library and online. What's the difference between taking notes at the library, from your textbooks, and online? Sooner or later, you'll have to return library books if you're allowed to take them out at all, and librarians tend to frown on highlighting them. And unless you plan to print out every web page you find and wield your magic highlighter, you need an effective system for taking notes right from the source, whether it's a library book, journal article, or web page. Of course, if you are so unfamiliar with your public or school library that you don't even know its address, you will have a hard time utilizing its offerings when a paper is assigned. Likewise, if your idea of efficient use of the internet is staying up to date on Kylie Jenner's latest musings and making sure to post on Instagram every hour on the hour, you will find researching a 15-page paper on Japanese internment camps during World War II, challenging. Score. Are your note-taking skills sufficient to summarize the necessary data from your textbooks? Are you able to capture the key points from classroom lectures and discussions? Are you such a ubiquitous presence in your library that they have named a study carol for you? Are you able to find a dozen key internet sites pertinent to any paper within minutes? If your note-taking skills allow you to master your textbooks, excel in class, find whatever information you need from a variety of sources, prepare detailed outlines, and write good papers, give yourself an A in each area. If you feel you are deficient in any one of these areas of note-taking, give yourself a B. If notes are what you pass to your friends in class, give yourself a C. Class participation. Most teachers take each student's class participation into account when calculating final grades, no matter how many pop quizzes they pull or how many term papers they assign. And you may have discovered there are teachers who will mark down even those students who ace every paper and quiz if they seem to disappear in the classroom. Score. If you are always prepared for class, which means at the very least reading all assigned material, preparing assigned homework and projects, and turning them in on time, actively participate in discussions and ask frequent and pertinent questions as a way of both trumpeting what you already know and filling in the gaps in that knowledge, give yourself an A. If you fail in any of these criteria, give yourself a B. If you aren't sure where the classroom is, give yourself a C. Writing papers and preparing oral reports. With apologies to Thomas Edison, preparing any sort of report, written or oral, is 90% perspiration, research, and 10% inspiration, writing. In other words, the ability to write a good paper is more dependent on your mastery of the other skills we've already discussed than your mastery of writing. If you are an avid reader, familiar with your local library, a veteran online researcher, a good note-taker, and capable of breaking down the most complex topic into the manageable steps necessary to write a paper, you probably turn in superior papers. Score. If you have already given yourself an A in library and online note-taking, time management, and reading, give yourself an A. If you feel you turn in relatively good papers, but definitely lack in any of these areas, give yourself a B. If your idea of writing a paper is photocopying the pertinent spark notes and retyping the summary, give yourself a C. Test preparation. The key to proper test preparation is knowing both what material will be covered and what form the test will take. Weekly quizzes of unit and/or chapter exams usually cover the most recent material. Midterms and finals cover a much broader area, usually all the subject matter to date. Multiple choice tests, essays, lists of math problems, and science lab tests all require different preparation and apply different test-taking skills. Knowing the kind of test you're facing will make your preparation much easier. So will creating a list of questions you think your teacher will most likely ask. By periodically reviewing your text and class notes, you'll begin to identify the areas in which your teacher appears most interested, and on which he or she is most likely to test you. As a final trick, prepare a list of 10 or more questions you would ask if you were the teacher. Score. If you are able to construct tests that are harder than the ones your teacher gives you and score well on his or hers, give yourself an A. If you feel you know the material but just don't perform as well as you think you should at test time, give yourself a B. If you didn't pass your driver's test, let alone algebra, give yourself a C. Your overall score. Once again, after you've rated yourself in each area, give yourself 2 points for every A, 1 point for every B, and 0 points for every C. If your overall rating is 17 or more, excellent, give yourself an A. 13 to 16, good, give yourself a B. 12 or less, fair, give yourself a C. Put your new score in the section Overall Study Skill Level in the chart. How closely did this more detailed evaluation compare with the score you gave yourself before listening to the rest of this chapter? If the latter was wildly off the mark, it just means you aren't as ready to toss this book as you thought you were. If your initial evaluation wasn't as positive as the more detailed one you just completed, you're in better shape than you thought. Now what? The fact that you have been honest with yourself in evaluating the talents you bring to the study game is a big plus in your favor. Knowing your areas of strength and weakness, especially the skills you need to develop or improve, will help you concentrate your efforts. Although I would strongly recommend you listen to the entire book, this simple test has enabled you to identify the chapters you really need to study and the specific skills that may require your continued attention long after you finish listening to this book. Chapter 2. Develop Your Plan. In order that knowledge be properly digested, it must have been swallowed with a good appetite. Anatole France. If you are failing every subject right now, I cannot promise that how to study will miraculously transform you into an A student. Clearly, something is very wrong or very lacking. But I can promise you that whatever your current grades and effort, you will undoubtedly experience a positive change if you put in the time to practice the skills in this book. You may not need to spend more time studying. You may simply need to learn how to study more efficiently, to use your time more economically, to study smarter. You may actually be able to devote less time and get better results. Learning of any kind takes discipline, and learning self-discipline is, to many of us, the most difficult task of all. But you absolutely can achieve better grades and more success if you put in the time to learn the lessons how to study contains, and more importantly, practice and use them every day. If you're currently doing little or nothing in the way of schoolwork, then you are going to have to devote more time and effort. How much more? Or even more generally, how long should you study? Until you get the results you want to achieve. The smarter you are and the more easily you learn and adapt the techniques in how to study, the more likely you will be spending less time on your homework than before. But the further you need to go, from D's to A's rather than B's to A's, the more you need to learn and the longer you need to give yourself to learn it. Don't get discouraged. you will see positive results surprisingly quickly. Make study habit-forming. If you're doing poorly in school but spending a reasonable amount of time studying, you may have poor study.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.